I like to think of myself as the English nut. But today I'm delighted to be with the original English nut, the big daddy of all English nuts, Dr. Shashi Tharoor.
Dr. Tharoor, thank you so much for doing this.
That is the most unusual introduction I've had, but thank you.
It's indeed a pleasure and a privilege, even though it's just for a short while, to be your interlocutor.
we are
going to be talking about the English language, of course. And I'm also going to subject you to the nutty English quiz, which you're going to ace because it's not on American slang or millennial lingo. It's about the English that we speak here in India today. But I'd like to start by asking you for a scoop. You've introduced India to many words like rhodomontade and farrago and hippopotamonstrous sesquipedaliophobia.
Mm.
So I'd like you to introduce us to one more of your favorite words.
Well, you know, when a kid asked me that at a gathering in a school in Trivandrum, I told him the word that I would introduce him to was to read. And he'd come across his own words, and I wouldn't have to spoon-feed him a word. But there are lots of interesting words. As you know, yesterday I reminded the nation of a word called snollygoster, which is an 1845 American concoction, meaning a shrewd and unprincipled politician. I had produced it when one particular chief minister jumped ship and went and joined the party he'd campaigned against. And when something similar seemed to be happening overnight on the weekend, I dusted this out and said, latest usage today. So that's one word which I think at least a lot of people now seem to be familiar with in India. Another word that I've been fond of in the sense that I feel it could be used more often, especially in our politics, is defenestrate. Defenestrate means literally to throw out of the window. But it's meant to be used to simply mean to reject, to discard, to expel all of those things. And I love that word. I've been using it since my college days. And I'm surprised that it's not more widely used. So defenestrate the political opportunists from our politics, for example, would be a good thing to do.
Are there any other English words that you've invented or would like to coin?
No, I coined one or two in the Great Indian Novel. Too embarrassing to mention in public. But they never caught on, so we can.
But please tell us.
No, I can't, not on TV.
Oh, okay.
This is going to remain on the net as a permanent indictment.
Oh, so it's
and
like
I coined
that.
A slightly naughty word in the Great Indian Novel, which I'll whisper to you and you can go and look it up later.
Okay.
But you won't catch me saying it.
Okay, all right.
But then I also coined a term which I wanted to see getting more popular, which is not really a new word particularly, but as Minister of State for External Affairs, I suggested in a couple of speeches that India was moving on beyond non-alignment to multi-alignment. When I said it, it kind of fell with a thud, and no one took it seriously, and no one quoted it and got no attention. Now it's come back into vogue, and I was complimenting my friend, the Foreign Minister, Jaishankar, that in one of his speeches, he used the term multi-alignment. So 10 years after I had tried and failed, it may be coming into circulation.
Right. That's fantastic. That's an exclusive for the English nut.
There you are for the English nut.
Thank you so much. Now, another subject which is close to your heart is about the British looting India. And loot is one of the words that you have written and spoken about in the past. Could you talk to us about some of the other words that the British have looted from India?
Oh, God, there are so many. I mean, there must be, without exaggeration, close to 1,000 words in the complete the big fat Oxford English Dictionary that have come from Indian languages. But some I wouldn't really count as English words because they're very obviously unchanged Indian words that they put in. Some, however, though very much current in English usage, and many English people don't realize have come from India, to the Indian ear are very obviously Indian, like jungle, bungalow, things that guru, yoga. I mean, many people, oddly enough, in the Western world don't realize that these words have come from Indian languages. But then there are the really surprising ones, words that don't actually look or sound Indian the way the British pronounce them, but which are actually derived from, and then of course mispronounced, Indian words. So one that I particularly was struck by when I discovered it about 10, 15 years ago was shampoo. Because shampoo came from the British saying champo, when they got their servants to wash their hair. So press and knead and rub your hair is champo. Everything was an imperative. And then I'm going for a champo became I'm going for a shampoo. And that's how shampoo came into being.
I believe a Bengali by the name of Sheikh Din Muhammad took it to...
And he actually set up an entire series of salons or spas where he offered the shampoo, exactly.
Right.
That Sheikh Din Muhammad from Bihar, actually, but Bihar was part of the Bengal presidency. That's
we
what
like
happened.
To take credit for everything.
You should, you should. The other one was cash, which comes from Tamil. I mean, I had no idea that cash came from. I mean, I could guess that mulligatawny soup was actually mulligatawny, which simply means hot pepper water. And that's in Tamil. But that cash had come from a Tamil word was a discovery to me. So things like that, I think there are quite a few. Even Wikipedia has over 100 from various Indian languages. And if you go into a more serious sort of philolinguistic study, I'm sure you'll get several hundred.
Right. Katamaran is another word.
That's again from Tamil, Kattamaram. In fact, Katta is literally to cut, and Maram is wood.
Right.
So that's what a catamaran is from. Yes. And then, of course, if you want to look at kamarbund, a very elegant English gentleman wearing something around his waist. Yeah. It's actually kamarbund, you see. Just as, by the way, this may surprise you, when you see pictures of these Mexican revolutionaries like Zapata with bandanas around their head, it comes from bandana. Bandana. Exactly.
Yeah, yeah. And bangles comes from bangli in
yes. Bangles, I think you could guess, no?
Yeah.
Jungle, bangle, etc.
Okay. Do you know the word for a type of clothing which is inspired by the neighborhood in of Bombay called Dongri?
No, I didn't know that. There is a neighborhood called Dongri. And that's the dungaree, I suppose.
The dungarees
yeah.
are from Dongri.
So there is an expression that is no longer really current in English for a big commotion, confusion racket called a dulali.
The dulali.
And that comes from Devlali.
I believe
the... Not to mention the Jalpa, which is the Jodhpur, of course.
Yeah. Right. And indigo, the word indigo too comes from the Greek word for India or Indian. You've also written about Indianisms like native place.
Mm-hmm.
So what are some of your other favorites?
Well, there are so many. Some of them just slip into conversation quite routinely. My favorite for the longest time was preporn because I thought I'd invented it. But we you know, air dash is another Indianism. Then the newspaper reports about police tracking down criminals always refer to history sheeters. That is, a criminal with a long record of crimes is called a history sheeter. Where that comes from is all Indian English. Then there's, of course, the expressions, you know, of which the most famous one is please adjust. Or kindly adjust, actually. Yeah. Not please adjust, kindly adjust. That is when a fifth person sits on a bench meant for two and says, kindly adjust.
Right.
Then there's also the classic, you know, we are like this only. So you can come up with a few of those.
So after the US, India has the second highest number of English speakers. And with our birth rate, I think we're soon going to have the highest number of English speakers.
Yeah, but the US has an immigration rate. So they've already reached, I think, over 300 million.
Okay.
Whereas our census severely undercounts us.
Yeah.
So we may find it difficult to have bragging rights over the actual numbers.
Right.
Because, for example, in the Indian census, I'm not considered an English speaker. Since the census only asked me what's my mother tongue, which is Malayalam. So I'm not listed. They didn't, at least the year that I did the census, there was no supplementary question saying what other languages do you know.
So they've underestimated the number.
Seriously underestimated. Yeah. In fact, I think the official census claim is 2% speak English.
Right.
Which is a massive undercut.
Correct.
So I would say the reality is somewhere between 10 and 20% with varying degrees of competence and fluency of the Indian population. Now, if you take that number, then you're looking at about 260 million, which is still lower than America.
So, but I think that with our birth rate, we are going to, you know, exceed.
All right. The, good for you and your faith in our birth rate.
So anyway, because that brings me to the next question, which I want to ask you. With the growing number of English speakers in India and with our growing influence in the world, do you think that passengers on the London Underground wearing cashmere sweaters will ask other passengers to kindly adjust? Will New Yorkers ask their meetings to be preponed? And will tanned Torontonians describe their complexion as wheatish?
Wheatish, that's a good one.
Do you think that these words will find their way into the rest of the
world? No, actually no. I'll tell you what. One of the strengths as well of English is the fact that there are so many regional variants. That, you know, there's a very distinctive Australian English which even New Zealanders can tell apart from a New Zealander's English, though we probably can't. And there are real distinctions between the English spoken around London and the English spoken around Yorkshire, let alone Scotland or Ireland. And all these variations have what makes it distinctive, and therefore Indian English has every right to be as distinctive as Irish English or American English. And it's curious, for example, that in India, at least for the longest time, I've not heard it much since returning to India, but when I left India, people still spoke in furlongs. How far are you away? Oh, it's just a couple of furlongs down the road. But no one in England has used furlong for 100 years. So we had a word in English.
Yeah.
Then there are these Indian words which don't exist in any Indian language and don't exist in any other form of the English language, like brinjal.
Right.
So in the Western world, it's eggplant, right? And in India, there is no Indian language where it's called brinjal. It's called bengan, it's called vaidhirinya in Malayalam, begun in Bangla.
Yeah.
But you can't have anyone saying brinjal except in Indian English.
Right.
So where did it come from? I haven't looked it up. But the fact is, it's an Indian English word that only exists in Indian English. So there'll be, that way there'll be variants. And perhaps history sheeter will join the list, perhaps prepon,
yes,
which I'm a big fan of, because I think, much easier to say, do you mind if we prepon our meeting? Rather than advance our meeting. Advance our meeting sounds, to my mind, quite odd. Whereas, since postpone is derived from, shoving something later, why not logically prepone?
And because you've lived in Calcutta, I'd like to ask you, what does dash push mean?
Dash push?
Yeah, I'm like sure. You say, or khub dash push ache.
Tell me.
Dr. Tharoor khub dash push ache. It means he's very dashing.
Oh, that comes from English, though.
Yeah, but
it's derived from
dash-push. I don't think exists anywhere.
That's right. Okay, that's
English.
A good word.
Yeah.
In Malayalam, we have a word that ought to exist in English, which is etramte, which means in a sequence of numbers or in a line or a queue or whatever, which particular one. So rather than saying what is the position of that person standing in that line, suppose the English nut says to me, I want you to meet my friend Aditi.
Yeah.
And there's a long line of about 20 collegians standing there. All I have to say Malayalam is etramte is she, which number position is she? There's no one word in any other language I know of, and I know a few. So I think that's a great word that should be applied in English.
But I was a bit surprised because, I always think of you as somebody who's, a stickler for the Queen's English. So
not
I didn't think that you would want to be associated with preborn. But
I'm very proud to be associated with it, except that I no longer am, because I actually took the trouble of boasting about it and was promptly ticked off by the Oxford English Dictionary, no less, that wrote to me with a citation from 100 years ago.
Yeah.
It never caught on very much, but it's been used here and there. They found an Indian usage in the 1950s as well, and an American usage in the first decade of the last century.
Thank you so much.
Pleasure.
Catch one English nut chatting with another.
He's the English nut. Bye for now.
And that brings us to the end of this episode of The English Nut with Dr. Shashi Tharoor. Watch all episodes of Dr. Shashi Tharoor chatting with me about the English language. Do subscribe to The English Nut on Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, and Twitter. From one English nut to another, thank you.